Welcome. Thank you for joining the Vector Controls and Automation Group webinar video conference session. I am Nikki Bowling, Marketing Director for Vector. Today we will talk about oil-free compressor technology and benefits. Dan Haber and your Vector host, Dan will be your Vector host, along with our Solaire subject matter expert, Rich Hugagore. Before we get started, please note that you have been muted. The GoToWebinar controls are located on the right of your screen and include a question option. Feel free to type a question there and we will answer at the end of the session. Additionally, there are some handouts available for your review. We have a Solaire product guide, which features the product showcased today. We also have a Vector Controls and Automation Group fact flyer and line cards. Feel free to download these now for your review and future reference. Now I will turn it over to our host, Dan.
Thank you, Nikki. Welcome, everybody. Thank you for taking some time out of your schedules to spend a few minutes with us this afternoon. For those of you I haven't had the pleasure of meeting, my name is Dan Haber, and I am with Vector's Mechanical Solutions Division. Within our group, we specialize in automated valve systems, and one of the other primary components is going to be something we're going to spend a little while talking about today. It's going to be our compressed air solutions. Today's webinar is going to be talking about the advantages of oil-free compressor systems, and hopefully should prove pretty educational for everybody. Again, at the end, if there are any questions, please join our interactive conversation and see how much information we can share with you this afternoon. And we will go ahead and turn it over to Mr. Rich Hugagore with Solaire Systems for our presentation. Thanks, Rich.
Thank you, Dan. Dan said, I'm Rich Hugagore. I'm with Solaire LLC. We are the one of the top three air compressor manufacturers in the world. We're a worldwide company, and we supply lots of compressed air products as well as treatment, air treatment, and things like that. So today's class is really to talk about the advantages of oil-free compressor systems. There's lubricated compressor systems, and there's also an oil-free type. And we're going to talk about some of the advantages of oil-free. But first, we'll talk about the introduction to air system components. We'll just go over how a properly designed air system should be compromised. And then we'll talk about how compressors work. So we'll look at the different compressor technologies available, both lubricated and oil-free. Then we'll do a comparison between those systems and show you some of the advantages between an oil-free system and a lubricated system. We're going to talk a little bit about the life cycle costs and benefits of both systems, and we'll finish up with just a quick overview of some of the oil-free products that Solaire offers, and then followed by a Q&A. First, let's talk about the air system components. So really, this diagram represents a properly designed compressed air system. So starting on the front of the system is your air compressor. So this can be various different kinds of air compressors. We'll learn a little bit about that later. So we make flow and pressure with the compressor, and it's recommended to go into a storage tank. So there's really three main purposes of a storage tank, or a receiver tank. For wet storage, what we're looking for is to smooth out the controls on the compressor. So it causes the compressor to react more slowly, so it doesn't load and unload too frequently. So that's one of the main purposes. Another one is to help knock down the temperature of the air before it goes into the air treatment. And then when you knock down the temperature, you remove moisture. So we're trying to pull out some liquid moisture out of the air, and this reduces the load downstream on the cleanup equipment. So generally following a wet storage tank, we have a separator element. So a filter that's main purpose is to remove oil, remove water from the system, and help, again, reduce the load on the dryers. So most air needs to be treated to reduce the moisture content, and that's what the dryer systems are. So there's really two main types. There's refrigerated dryers, which generally give you a dew point down to 38 degrees Fahrenheit, and the Duskin dryer, which can go down to minus 40, minus 80, minus 120. There's all kinds of different ranges. So if you need extra dry air, a desk and dryer is generally used. The main purpose of removing water from the system is to prevent liquid water from forming in the piping downstream, so as the liquid water can get into components and cause problems. Generally, we have filtration after your dryers, and that filtration is mostly to cover particulates at this point, and any residual oil or liquid that may get past the dryer. So at this point, there's also going to be carbon filters and other chemical filters, other things to remove hydrocarbons and give you the lowest contamination in your air. Then generally we like to go into a dry storage tank, and what this tank will do is it helps reduce the fluctuations downstream of the compressor and dryer. So the dryer and compressors are doing different things that can affect the flow going through the system. If you are able to store at higher or generate and store compressed air at a higher pressure, then a flow controller can be used to regulate the flow to the plant at a very tight pressure band of 1 or 2 PSI. So a flow controller can be used there. And then just about every step of the way along the system, we are, as we drop the temperature and clean up the air, we often bring liquids out, which can be a mix of atmospheric water and then also lubricant and coolants if we're using a lubricated compressor system. So all those are collected, and generally if you have a lubricated system, you have an oil and water separator to separate the water from the oil so that you can better treat those products. So when we're looking at a lubricated system or an oil-free system, it generally looks the same. The exception with the oil-free system is the condensate that comes out of oil-free is just atmospheric water. There's no lubricants. So often you don't have to have an oil water separator. Also, we're able to reduce the amount of filtration downstream with an oil-free compressor. So you may have two filters, even though one's shown here. You may have one that's for oil separation and another one for liquids, for water, things like that. So sometimes you'll be able to reduce that, and then you'll be able to reduce the after filtration because you won't have to use like a carbon filter or something like that to remove oil and hydrocarbon residue because it's you don't have any lubricant on an oil-free system. Let's talk about how compressors work now. So there's two types of compression technology, positive displacement compression. Most of the compressors that you see are positive displacement. So it compresses air by mechanically decreasing the volume around the air. So if, for example, we have a piston compressor, we're using a piston to physically squeeze the air into a smaller space and thus compressing it. With a scroll compressor, we're doing the same thing. We're bringing the air from the outside to the center and we're squeezing it smaller. And then rotary screw takes the air from one end of the rotors and pushes it towards the other end, thereby compressing it. So when you have positive displacement compression, you have to have tight clearances. You often have to have special seals and materials to fill those gaps. So that's positive displacement compression. And those parts often have to be, they wear out and need to be changed. So there's generally more maintenance with positive displacement compression. The other type is dynamic compression. This is your centrifugal air compressors and blowers and things like that that compress air. And the way it's done is using velocity. So we speed the air up to a high speed, and then we slow it down rapidly by running it through a small space. When that happens, it causes the molecules in the air to compress and bunch up, similar to if you were coming up on a red light and the traffic all slows down and bunches up. It's kind of the same thing. We speed it up, we slow it down, and it's a continuous process. So the two types of compression out there, we'll talk about the piston compressor next. So the piston compressor is positive displacement. They're generally smaller in size. And in this class, we're really talking about instrument air systems. I just want to clarify. Certainly, there are very large piston compressors in the oil and gas and petrochemical markets for generally for high pressure, high flow situations. So in this case, we're talking about an instrument air. So a small system may have a piston type compressor. The advantage to that is that they're low equipment costs. They're generally very cheap to buy. They're capable of high discharge pressures. They're energy efficient. and they are typically for low flow applications when we talk about instrument air. Some of the disadvantages, the high maintenance costs of replacing piston rings and seals, things like that all the time. The lower flow, so you're not able to get use these on large scales generally for instrument air systems. They generally don't run continuously. You have to have a cycle where they're on and off. Therefore, you have a pressure point that goes up and down inside the system. If you're using a lubricated type, which most are, you're going to have additional downstream filtration to remove oil. The condensate would have oil in it, and it consumes oil, so you'd have to frequently top off and store and dispose of lubricants. So, and there are oil-free versions of the piston compressors, but they have a very short lifespan as far as the parts need to be, piston rings need to be replaced on a frequent basis. The next type of compressor to talk about is the lubricated rotary screw. So I already talked a little bit about how the technology works. So instead of seals and mechanical piston rings and things like that, these rotors have a fluid that's injected in and mixed with the air. So as the fluid kind of fills in the gaps between the rotors and acts, as the seal that pushes the air from one end to the other. And then after the oil and air mixture, the compressed air and oil mixture, go through a mechanical separator element that uses centrifugal force, impingements, and filtration to knock out the liquid mist. And there's just a very small amount, usually 4, 5, 6 parts per million of oil that will leave the compressor. So the advantages of a lubricated rotary screw is low equipment costs. They're generally inexpensive to buy relative to other types of compressors. Because they're using a fluid in the air, the equipment lasts a long time, so you have a reliable and long lifespan of the equipment. And generally, they're one of your most energy efficient solutions, under 300 horsepower. Some disadvantages are the discharge air has oil contamination, so this can get downstream to cause problems, which we'll talk about later. You have higher maintenance costs because of frequent changes of the oil separator element and the large amount of lubricant that's consumed in these machines. And generally, these have high performance synthetic lubricants that can get quite costly to replace and to top off with. And again, because it's oil lubricated, you're going to have additional downstream filtration, and your condensate will have to be treated as well to remove the oil. Next, we're talking about the oil-free rotary screw. So this is a similar technology that I just explained with the lubricated rotary screw. The main difference with this technology is we're not using a lubricant coolant in the rotor area. So we do not mix a lubricant with air. So we're bringing in atmospheric air, running it through these screws at high speed, a higher speed. The screws are closer together. They have special coatings on them to prevent, to help with lubrication and to prevent overheating and rusting. And then we also have a seal system that separates the oil that's in the gearing area. So a lubricated rotary screw does have oil in it, but it's only used on the gearing side. So it's a gear type, engine type oil. And then we use a sealing system to separate the two. We also deal with higher temperatures and faster speeds in order to make the air without having the sealing lubricant in between the rotors. So the main advantages of the rotary screw oil-free is no oil contamination. So the only thing that comes out of this machine is air and then the atmospheric water that was in the air, anything that was brought into the machine. So it's very clean air that comes out. There's an ISO standard 8573-1. There's different standards of air cleanliness. With an oil-free compressor, it's the only compressor that can reach class zero. If you have a lubricated system and you want to reach class zero, you do need some special filtration, including some heat-activated filtration that burns off and removes carbon filters. There's a whole lot of stuff that's needed to do that. But with this kind of system, you have clean air coming out. It's a reliable, proven design. It's energy efficient, generally lower maintenance costs than lubricated machines because we're no longer dealing with a separator, oil separator elements, and topping off lubricants. So There's some actually less parts and labor involved with a lubricated, or I'm sorry, with an oil-free rotary screw compressor. Because it's oil-free, you have less downstream filtration, and the water, the condensate that comes out of these machines is clean. This is atmospheric water, so depending on your local code, this water doesn't have to be treated. It could just go to sewer. Some of the disadvantages is the high initial cost. So an oil-free compressor will cost more than a lubricated compressor of the same horsepower. And again, that's because we're using higher speeds, more precision. And also, these are always two-stage machines in order to get the pressure and flow required. The ARN has a shorter lifespan than a rotary screw. It's something that's generally replaced every 8 to 12 years. And we have a higher noise level with these. These machines are always have an enclosure that's there for sound. Next compressor we'll talk about is a scroll compressor, excuse me. So the scroll compressors are used in smaller flow applications. They are oil-free positive displacement machines. So they make really clean air and generally for small. They're also very quiet. So the way the technology works is we have two spirals. One's the stationary spiral shown in black. The red spiral is the orbiting scroll. And what that does is it draws a pocket of air represented by the little blue circles from the outside and brings it in towards the middle. So as you go from the outside of the circle to the middle, you're decreasing the volume around the air and compressing it. So this technology was originally invented for or used for refrigeration type compressors, still is today. The Solair actually adapted it to be used for industrial air applications as well. Some of the advantages of this machine is it's oil-free, so again, it meets ISO class 0 air, so it gives you the cleanest possible air. It's a reliable design. If it's sized properly, you can go 2 to 3 years without any major maintenance before you have to start looking at replacing tip seals and things like that. Less downstream filtration because it's oil-free. Clean condensate, as we talked about. And a little different is these are technically an oil-less compressor. There's no oil in it at all. So each pump uses greased bearings with a long life grease that's supposed to last the life of the tip seals and bearings and things like that. So another advantage is very low noise. So these packages are generally installed indoors. And they're great for in the same room as the equipment that they're servicing. You can have them in laboratories, analyzer buildings, things like that, where you have you need to have some very clean compressed air, and it meets all the noise requirements of being indoors without hearing protection. So great machine for that technology. The final technology you'll talk about is the centrifugal compressor. So centrifugal compressors are generally seen in larger applications, generally from 300 to up to 30,000 horsepower. That's used in smaller or large instrument air systems, but also in process systems. So you see a lot of centrifugals in larger factories and plants. And it's one of your longest lasting technologies. So some of the advantages of it's oil-free, it's super reliable, probably the lowest maintenance and cost long-term of any compressor. Less downstream filtration because it's oil-free, clean condensate. They're just great machines. Some of the disadvantages is the higher purchase costs and install costs. So there's a lot of assembly and piping around the compressor that needs to be put in. And also these are only available in water-cooled versions. But again, because of the long life and the energy efficiency of these, it is your most efficient compressor type. Just general rule of following your size and compressors is most of your compressors can offer you 4 to 5 CFM per horsepower. When you get into centrifugals, you get into the fives and high fives when it comes to the amount of air you can make with the same horsepower. So you generally have a smaller footprint and able to get a lot of flow out of these machines. So we've talked about the technology. Let's get into the some of the benefits of oil-free systems. So when we look at the two different systems, a lubricated and an oil-free system, we really kind of look at some of the advantages and disadvantages. So to be frank, any air compressor system could be an oil-free system. Most of the reason why they're not is because of the lower initial cost of lubricated equipment. So if a customer can tolerate oil-free or having some oil in their instrument air, then they'll often go with this system. And there's some customers that just require oil-free. They have to have it. They have a special process. They have a very low tolerance of contamination in the processing area, and things like that. Initially they're more expensive to install, but over time, because of the lower maintenance costs and the lower problems you have downstream with your other equipment, including process and quality and things like that, the cost of ownership ends up being about the same or better than a lubricated system when you account all the downstream equipment as well. So when I talk about downstream equipment, I'm talking about filters and dryers up near the compressors, but then also the point of use equipment. So any point of use filtration that you have, every time you drop a line, if you put a small filtration, point of use filtration regulator on there, those are sensitive, very sensitive to dirt and lubricant debris getting into them. So when you go to an oil-free system, there's no oil carryover that builds up over the years, and it keeps all the equipment downstream cleaner. So there's less maintenance, less filters, less problems with quality and things like that. So the downstream air treatment actually lasts longer. In fact, dryers actually should perform better and last longer, whether it's refrigerated or a desk and dryer, simply because both technologies rely on a clean surface area for heat exchange or exchange of moisture. And if your desk and beads and your desk and dryer start to get clogged up with oil, then the performance goes down on their ability to dry the air. And then with refrigerated dryers, your heat exchanger, if it starts to get clogged up and dirty, then your efficiency of your heat exchanger drops, and it causes your compressors to run more often, and you're not able to achieve as low dew points as you would if you had a clean heat exchanger. So those are the main reasons. When we look at installation costs on a lubricated system, is generally lower than oil-free. The yearly maintenance, however, is higher. So when you go out 20 years on your oil, on your air system, you'll see that the advantage of the lower cost of the oil-free system will kind of balance that out. You get class zero air with oil-free. The energy use is a little bit better with lubricated units, but then if you're able to actually lower the pressure of your compressors by going through less filtration, then the energy use becomes better. So it's really kind of neck and neck in that regard. Air treatment lasts longer. Environmental, you have better environmental compliance by not having a lot of lubricant spilling out on the ground or having to store and dispose of these items. And the total life cycle costs are pretty similar in the long run. When they go 20 years, sometimes the oil-free system's a little better, sometimes the lubricated's a little better, just depends on the application. But the point is, while it costs more to install in the beginning, you're going to get long-term, you're going to get better performance out of the system, better air, and your costs are actually going to be actually lower, even though you paid more for the equipment in the long run. Some of the risk factors we talked about, just a little more detail on that, the contamination. So with a lubricated system, there is a carryover of oil, 4 to 5 parts per million, and that's if everything's running perfectly, brand new system. So as your system ages, your compressor ages, if you're running compressor unloaded a lot, your lubricated compressor will actually pass more oil down the system. Also, filtration's rated for 70 degrees temperature. Typically, filters are seeing higher temperatures than that, and their efficiency goes way down as the temperature goes up, passing more oil down the system. So, the contamination of the processing downstream. So, if the lubricant gets into your process, your final product, and it contaminates that's a problem. So, your end product and your process, if it disrupts your process where you can't get the consistent results you need, it could be attributed to the contamination from the compressed air system. Your equipment actually gets contaminated and plugged up I talked about the point of use filtration tries to catch most of that. So you end up cleaning those a lot. And, you know, we've had customers that reports that the oil, you know, ruins those, some of their more sensitive equipment, instrumentation and things like that. Also environmental. So the areas around everywhere you expel air, your dryer, mufflers, vents, anywhere you're using the air, you're actually, you know, would be spraying a small amount of oil in that area. And over time that builds up and you start seeing, you know, oily spots around the equipment and, you know, a film of oil. If you have an indoor plant, kind of coating all the equipment around where the air is used. So you just a much cleaner environment. Your employees aren't breathing that in. They're not having to clean it, and just it's a much cleaner system. And the contamination for product spoilage is something that falls into that as well. Reliability, again, comes down to if you have equipment that's sensitive to contamination, instrumentation, and things like that, your dryers, you're going to have better reliability with an oil-free system. Liability for having problems. So something gets out the door with contamination, has to be, you know, rejected by the customer, or liability for being late or having the plant shut down. All those things are kind of tied into having a reliable air system. Brand reputation. If you have too many problems with, you know, contaminated products leaving your factory or your process, then it starts to affect the brand of your company. And then finally, increased maintenance costs with contamination. So if you're always having to call in a service tech to come fix your dryer or fix your compressor or your downstream equipment because of oil contamination, then that greatly decreases with an oil-free system. Some of the areas where you see a lot of oil-free systems used are, there's some customers on this list that have to have it, like pharmaceuticals, industrial gases generally use oil-free systems on the larger plants. Your textiles, electronics, and semiconductors, all they have to have oil-free, but there's also other industries like food and beverage, metallurgical, chemical, and petrochemical use a lot of it, especially when you get to large flows. A lot of these customers will switch to centrifugal compressors. As I said, they go up to 20 or 30,000 horsepower. So side benefit of using those larger centrifugal compressors is, besides the energy efficiency and long-lasting parts in them, is also that it's oil-free. So it's kind of a side benefit. A lot of customers that have large customers that on this list, so in snowmaking especially, they use a lot of air. And it's nice and clean air, not to get on the snow on the mountains and you know, with oil in it. So these are a lot of the ones that do that, use the oil-free systems. Kind of wrapping up talking about designing a system that is reliable and fills in your needs and benefits. So compressed air is usually the most expensive utility in the plant. So more expensive than power and water and gas. It's going to be compressing air because it does take a lot of energy to compress air. Therefore, a properly sized compressor system needs to be paired with correct oil or air treatment to give you what you need. The reliability and uptime can be improved with the correct type of compressor and air treatment. Most compressor issues are due to improper sizing or selection of components, or you have a system that was designed properly when the plant opened, and over time, you've changed the system, added more, removed air needs, all these things that kind of affect your compressors. So we encourage you to please utilize your local compressed air experts to help you design an air system and even upgrade and correct your air system as you grow over time. So there's a lot of great people that support the compressor industry, including Vector, and Solair is definitely a partner with them. This is a little bit about the, you know, total cost of owning a compressed air system. So, you know, a lot of customers are concerned about price, and that's why they tend to buy the lower price lubricated compressors. But as you can see, over the lifetime of a compressor system, let's say this is 20 years, your equipment and installation cost is only 15% of your total cost of ownership. 20% of the price you pay for your compressed air system will be maintenance costs, parts, and labor. You know, keeping the system running. And then the biggest number by far is your power costs. So by utilizing compressed air experts like Vector and Solaire when you design your systems. You make sure that you get the properly sized system. It's not oversized, it's not wasting, it's not slight over cycling and wasting energy, and that you have the lowest possible cost through parts service and lack of contamination and just having a reliable air system. In order to help you with the design of these systems, we need to know a few things from you. So a flow, anticipated flow for what you need. This can be based on existing data from compressors you have, or if you're building a new plant, this is based on what engineering thinks the equipment will need. And for flow, we like to know a minimum, a maximum, an average, how many days a week. So really the best thing to do is have a flow meter in there. Most of the flow meter software has a great tool for charting and graphing the air, so we know how it does over time. The pressure that you need is pretty self-explanatory. It's just keep in mind that you need to understand the pressure drops to your plant and figure out what the minimum set pressure will be at the compressor in order by the time it gets through all the cleanup equipment and down to that end of the plant that you have enough pressure there. We'd like to know the ambient conditions, the temperature, humidity. That's important because the size of the compressor changes depending on the temperature and humidity. Is it continuous duty? Is it intermittent? Does the compressor sit for a while before it's used? Those kind of things. Installation location, is it indoors, outdoors? A lot of customers love to put compressors inside hot boiler rooms and things like that, or outdoors. It's very popular. So, and if you want your equipment to last longer, we generally like to put a roof over it or keep it in a well-ventilated area. What kind of storage capacity do you have, both in tanks, storage tanks, and also the amount of piping you have in the system, so we know, what kind of control strategy to use. What kind of dew point do you need? Does your piping go outside where it freezes? Even in Texas, up in Dallas and Northern, we get freezes. So, if it goes outside, you're going to have a lower dew point than 38 degrees. So you may have to go to desk and dryers, things like that. And then what's your backup strategy? Are you going to have one compressor running the plant and one backup that's 100%? Are you going to have two or three compressors at 50% running the plant? So we really need to know your backup strategy so we can make sure that we have the best reliability for you. I'll finally finish up with just a quick overview of some of the compressors that products that Solaire offers. We offer oil flooded rotary screws, oil free rotary screws, scrolls, a huge line of dryers and filtration and after equipment, and centrifugal compressors. So we offer three different types of oil free compressors, the ones we talked about, the rotary screw, the scroll, and the centrifugal. And then finally, we've been building compressors almost 54 years now, I think, and out of Michigan City, Indiana. As I said earlier, we're in the top three compressor manufacturers in the world in order of volume. So we could certainly have a product to fit your needs. And with that, we'll turn it back over to Dan and answer any questions that you have.
Thank you, Rich. Obviously, Vector is very proud to be an OEM partner for Solaire. Can't thank you enough for your time and putting this presentation together for us. My simple summary of it is, and what I tell people all the time, if we never introduce oil into their compressed air system, we don't have to remove it, is I think one of the highlights of the oil-free air compressors. Nikki, will you, I guess, open us up for questions?
I sure can, and we do have a couple. First one would be, would switching to food grain lubricants solve lubricant contamination concerns for food and beverage companies?
That's a good question. That's a great question. So, surprisingly, food and beverage doesn't all use oil-free systems. They're not required to by the FDA or anything like that. So over the years, as customers have more concern about contamination in the food, there's a big push for clean organic food, and so customers are starting to push back on manufacturers that air systems and to upgrade those. So you can switch from a regular petroleum-based lubricant over to a food grade of your lubricant, which is generally a food oil based. But the problem with that is it's only a band-aid. You're still getting that lubricant, still is in the food and getting in the plant. And also it doesn't have the same life expectancy as lubricants, standard lubricants. So you're going to be changing the oil more often, the filtration more often. And also in some cases, you know, leads to varnishing inside the machine and then, a lot of, residue building up in pipes. So to answer the question, you know, it's a temporary solution, a band-aid solution, but as soon as possible, you should consider moving over to a true oil-free machine.
Okay, great. Next question. Can Vector also provide service or only the new equipment?
Rich, I'll go ahead and grab that one. Yes, Vector can provide new equipment. We can provide service for emergency repairs, for preventative maintenance, for troubleshooting systems and ongoing systems like that. And it's not limited to just the solar equipment we've been talking about this afternoon, but our service guys are prepared to service all brands of compressors and air dryers. Thanks, Nikki.
Okay, great. Next question. Do we have to replace the piping to remove the contamination if we switch to an oil-free system?
Well, that's up to the customer's tolerance for the contamination. So if they have a real bad contamination problem, the piping's, you know, really old, 20 years old, and yeah, if you switch to an oil-free system, you should remove that piping and replace it with clean piping. And in some cases, some customers just by using the air over time, it eventually kind of cleans out the moisture and the lubricant in the system, and they end up, you know, having a great reduction over time. Some customers, you know, will purge the air system for a few weeks just by running it, cracking open a few valves here and there, and just to try to get all that little bit of oil out. But a good question. You can go either way. So we do recommend that you do change the piping out if it's able to do that. But if you have a huge facility and it's not cost effective to do that, then you'll have to continue using point of use filtration until that piping is dried out over a few years.
Okay, great. Next question. Can you give a little bit more detail on how lubricated compressors shorten the life of dryers and other downstream components?
Yeah, sure. So I guess I'll start with the desiccant dryer, which probably has the biggest impact. So the manufacturers of desiccant give a lifespan to activated aluminum desiccant of about 5 years. So if you take care of the machine and run it normally, you should get 5 years out of desiccant. But we're finding that most customers have to change it within 2 to 3 years if they're using a lubricated system. So by going to an oil-free system, I guess the main reason for that is that there's small pores inside the desiccant that kind of mechanically absorb the water, and as these pores get filled with oil, the oil does not get removed when they regenerate the bed. So you start having these little pores are clogged up, and the ability for them to hold water is greatly reduced over time. So that's the main one. And then I think I talked about the refrigerated one. Just by clogging up the heat exchanger, it's going to cause you to run your refrigerant compressor is going to run more frequently, which uses more energy and then shortens the life of that compressor. So, and then ultimately you'll have a reduction in your performance and higher dew points, which could lead to getting liquid water in your system.
Okay, great. Next question. Does Vector offer any types of training for these products or this technology?
Yes, Nikki, we do. While it's not officially part of our Vector University program yet, we are looking at adding that in the future. But currently what we have to offer for customers is we'll do lunch and learns. We'll bring in our subject matter expert partners, such as Rich from Solaire, and we can do more in-depth training and education for our customers of all the different types of technology that are out there and the pros and cons of each one, and then sit down with the customer and figure out what best fits applications. So we can do some training on a customer by customer basis.
Okay, great. And it looks like I have one more question here. Question is, what is it that sets Solaire's oil-free compressors apart from the competition?
Yeah, good question. So there's a lot of manufacturers that make oil-free compressors. What it really comes down to is the quality of the components. So there's all our oil-free compressors is based on conservative Japanese engineering. So we have very long-lasting components in these machines. We have several patents on our rotor screw and scroll technology for high temperature, long lasting materials and ways to extend the life of the coolers. We have some pre-coolers that are patented as well. So with the solar equipment, our reputation as the bulletproof air end is kind of our nickname over the years. And so, every solar compressor is really built to last. So we're kind of a premium product in the market of compressors compared to a lot of other brands, which are more heavy in the maintenance and less shorter lifespans overall.
Rich, hasn't Solair been manufacturing oil-free compressors since like the late 60s, if memory serves me correctly?
Yeah, that's right. We are owned by Hitachi. Hitachi's been a pioneer in that they invented scroll technology. They had the first single stage rotary screw, oil-free rotary screw, and things like that. So yeah, our experience goes back more with we started out with lubricated machines, but we've always had some oil-free offerings, especially also in pistons too. The piston machines, the Bebicon is just known worldwide. As a Hitachi, it's just a Hitachi product that's just known for its great reliability.
Great.
Okay, that wraps up our question portion of the webinar today. I want to thank everyone for joining us, and we trust that it was a worthwhile experience and that you learned from our experts and have some valuable takeaways. Have a great rest of the day.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.